Surviving in the Kalahari Desert. The Kalahari Desert, it's blistering hot, it's dry, food is scarce, and there are hungry predators that want to snack on you. How on earth do any animals survive in such a hostile environment? G'day, I'm Piet van Dijk, and in this video we will explore the incredible tricks animals use to stay alive in the Kalahari. Certain of these tricks are common sense, others are little known, and then there are a few that are nothing less than amazing. Let's start by saying a few more things about the Kalahari. When you visit the Kalahari during a drought, and these are more the rule than the exception, you'll soon realize it's not the prime real estate for animals. The Tswana name Kalahari means dry place, and it's indeed a dry, hot and sandy place. One's first impression of this wilderness is therefore often one of desolation. Red sands stretching to the horizon. Dried up salt pans hurting the eyes. Fossil river beds and calcareous valleys meandering aimlessly through a landscape shimmering in the heat. Lonely looking camel thorn and shepherd's trees dotting the landscape. Bone dry grasses ready to ignite with the first flash of lightning. Because of its size, the Kalahari is not an easy place to escape from. It stretches over a huge area, covering 2.5 million square kilometers or 1 million square miles. The surface of the Kalahari is covered by the largest continuous sand mantle on Earth, spread over a large part of central southern Africa. Not a place you want to get lost in, as some hapless trekkers discovered during the 1800s when they ventured to take their ox wagons across this wasteland. But that is another story. But let's not exaggerate, the Kalahari is not a true desert, although it may look like it during dry years. More accurately, it can be described as dry savanna or semi-desert. That is an area where surface water is either scarce or absent for most of the time. Rainfall in the Kalahari is not only low, but it is also unpredictable. Even during average years, most of the Kalahari receive a mediocre 150 millimeters or 6 inches of rain. During bad years, it may not rain at all. Temperatures exceeding 45 degrees Celsius, that is 110 degrees Fahrenheit, are common during the long summer months. This means that little moisture that does fall is quickly lapped up by the unforgiving sun. However, after exceptional rains, the shallow salt pans fill up with water, and the fossil rivers such as the Aop and Nosop may even for a limited time contain runoff water. These good years, although scarce, play an important role in replenishing the underground water of the Kalahari and thus help to maintain the whole ecosystem. But the trick is not to survive in such good years. The secret is to stay alive when surface water is absent or scarce, food is scant, and the heat is unbearable. Surviving in the Kalahari is therefore not easy. So let's look at the four major ways animals may die in the Kalahari. First, because of lack of water. We all know that you can survive quite a long time without food, but without water in some form or another, any person or animal will soon croak. Heat stroke, caused by the combination of extreme heat and lack of water, is another enemy of any animal in the Kalahari. The third thing is a lack of food. This is also a major concern. Slowly starving to death is not the most pleasant way of dying. And if these three are not enough to make you want to just lie down and die, there are always lions, leopards, cheetahs, eagles, and other predators that may regard you as a delightful and tasty bite. But this is only half the story. When you do take the bold step to leave your comfortable air-conditioned home and visit the Kalahari wilderness, you will be surprised. Instead of the death trap that you may expect, you'll see a plethora of animals. Animals not only making a living, but frolicking around. Springbok jumping. ostriches dancing and displaying, ground squirrels playing, secretary birds strutting around, red-billed quailia swarming in their thousands. How the heck do they do it? The short answer is, they have some neat tricks up their sleeves. Tricks that enable them not only to escape death, but to prosper. Let's first consider the most imminent danger, the shortage of water. It's all good and well if you have enough surface water in 1 year, but what do you do the next year when no or very little water is available? As I said before, the trick is not to survive in a good year, but to make it through a bad one. And the Kalahari has more bad than good years. The good news is that humans have during the past drilled boreholes and established a number of artificial waterholes, especially in the Ob and Nosop riverbeds. The easiest way if you're an animal is to make sure you're within striking distance of such an artificial waterhole. There is, however, two problems with this strategy. You're not alone in the Kalahari. If you're going to stick near the limited number of waterholes, you can be sure that many other animals are going to do the same. This means that most of the food around the waterhole will soon be depleted and you will have to travel each day further and further to get a few mouthfuls of grass or leaves, and that in a period of low rainfall when grass and leaves will be scarce to start with. There's also a more ominous reason why an artificial waterhole may be a death trap. Given the limited number of such waterholes and the congregation of prey animals around it, predators will be lurking. Droughts are the best times for predators. What is easier to catch your prey than when they are weakened by the lack of food, desperate to get some water, and are present in large numbers? That is why your best chance of seeing lion, leopard, and cheetah will be around these waterholes. Also, eagles, falcons, and other birds of prey will be waiting around. When food becomes scarce and there are too many lions around your favorite waterhole, the next option is to migrate to a better place. Given the huge size of the Kalahari, there's always a chance that the grass will be greener on the other side of the horizon. So many animals throw their heads up, sniff the air, and move en masse to a better place. In earlier years, huge migrations of especially springbok, eland, and other antelope were common in southern Africa. Today, it's mostly wildebeest and red-heartedbeest that tend to follow the thunderstorms. But again, migration has its own set of problems. Life is never easy. In the first place, it's expensive to migrate. The cost of energy is often too much for the old and young ones. Lions would also wake up one morning and say, "Hi, the pesty springboks are on the walkabout again. Let's follow them." Another problem is human fences. Fences erected to contain diseases such as foot and mouth disease now crisscross large parts of the Kalahari, especially in Botswana. These fences severely restrict movements of animals. So migration is not as attractive as it used to be in bygone years. If you want to survive in the Kalahari, you therefore have to have some more tricks in your repertoire. One other trick is to become water independent. This term is of course not entirely accurate because no animal can survive without some source of water. What is true is that some animals can survive without drinking water. Either indefinitely or for long periods, for example during the winter months when it doesn't rain in the Kalahari. This is possible because grasses and plants contain water. If you are a herbivore that eat plants, you therefore ingest water with your food. But unfortunately, during the dry season, the moisture content of grasses and plants drop to very low levels. This is the bad news. The good news is that there are numerous plants in the Kalahari wilderness that produce fruit containing loads of water. Some examples are tsamas, small watermelons, which are especially abundant of the good years and can remain fresh for months, even years in the dry atmosphere. Gemsbok and springbok cucumbers are much smaller but also contain water. If you know where to dig, you can also uproot tubers containing surprising amounts of water, even though they may look completely desiccated. Metabolic water is another source of moisture. It's a convenient byproduct of cell respiration. For the sake of those who did not pay enough attention in the biology class, all living organisms, plants and animals are made up of cells. Inside these body cells, energy is produced through a metabolic process known as respiration. Respiration needs two basic things to take place: food to burn and oxygen. Remember, burning is a process where something bonds with oxygen. That is why most animals need both food and oxygen to stay alive. Therefore, any food, even dry seeds, which is burnt, also release some water during this metabolic process. The predators of the Kalahari, such as lions, leopards, and cheetahs, can also go without drinking water for extended periods of time. This is possible because they consume some moisture while munching on the underdone steaks retrieved from the carcasses of their prey. The moist stomach contents and entrails of their prey also provide additional moisture. Birds have less of a problem in finding water because they can fly for long distances to waterholes. This becomes clear when observing the large number of quillas, doves, pigeons and sand grouse congregating around these waterholes in the Kalahari. But how do birds get water back to their chicks in the nest? Most chicks get their moisture by eating juicy insects, but also, of course, through metabolic water. Namaqua and Burchell sand grouse in the Kalahari, however, have an interesting adaptation which allows them to bring water to their chicks. They have special feathers on their breasts that can absorb water. When visiting a waterhole, they therefore crouch in the shallows to allow their feathers to suck up water, which they then take back to their chicks. A useful adaptation in this dry and hot environment. Animals also use strategies to conserve water. Many herbivores feed during nighttime when the water content of grasses and leaves is at their highest. Many animals also produce the minimum of sweat. Panting, like you see in this ostrich, conserves more water than sweating and have other benefits, to which we will come back later. Certain animals also reabsorb water by producing concentrated urine and dry feces. But birds and reptiles have a special way to conserve water. They produce solid pee or uric acid and can therefore reabsorb a lot of water. Uric acid is the white part of bird and reptile droppings. Not only water is a problem in the Kalahari, but also overheating. To prevent overheating is not easy in a water-scarce area, but the Kalahari animals have also adapted to this. First, as far as possible, they rest in the shade of trees during the extreme heat of the day. Shepherd trees are common and provide excellent shade. The temperature in the shade of these trees can be more than 10 degrees Celsius lower than the ambient temperature. These natural air conditioners of the Kalahari therefore make a significant difference in preventing overheating in animals. There is, however, a drawback. Sand tampons, a species of tick found in the sandy soil of the Kalahari, often lie in wait in large numbers in the shade of these shepherd trees. Apparently, they also like the shade. Or is that just where their chances of finding an animal are best? Not only do these ticks inject toxins into their host, but they often feed in such large numbers on an animal that they may cause significant blood losses. For animals, it is like being between the devil and the deep blue sea, having to choose between excruciating heat or ticks sucking out their blood. What would you choose if you were an animal in the Kalahari? If trees are not readily available, there's also another shady option. Make your own shade. Ground squirrels are day active and often must gather food during very hot periods. Fortunately, they have a conveniently built-in umbrella, their tails. You will therefore often see ground squirrels hiding from the sun under their tails. Another option for these squirrels is to dive into their cool underground chambers, spread their bodies as wide as possible and lie down on the cool underground sand. This way they get rid of excess heat and can after a time re-emerge to continue with their foraging. Sociable weavers have the most spectacular way of creating their own shade. They all work together and produce humongous grass canopies, bigger than the largest beach umbrella. Beneath this canopy, each couple hang their little nest, cool and difficult for a snake to access and eat their eggs or chicks. If no shade is available, there are other options. A highly reflective coat is one possibility. Springbok, gemsbok and eland all have light-colored and reflective coats, which like mirrors, reflect some of the heat of the sun away from them. Orientating your body in such a way that you catch as little sun as possible, the opposite of tanning on the beach, is another way to avoid too much heat. Some animals in the Kalahari avoid overheating by becoming partly or entirely night active. As mentioned earlier, this is also the time when plants contain most moisture. In the summer months, many herbivores therefore feed mostly during the night or early mornings. Some examples of mostly night active animals are bat-eared foxes, lions, leopards, hyena, and owls. However, during cold winter days, some of these animals may also be active during the daytime. If the previously mentioned strategies are not enough in a heat wave that in the Kalahari may last for months, there's another trick: thermoregulation. It's especially mammals and birds that have problems with extreme heat. In contrast to lizards, frogs, and insects, mammals and birds are endothermic, a problematic but still to some degree useful term. So-called endothermic animals produce their own body heat and maintain a constant temperature. The advantage of being endothermic is that it's easier to remain active during cold spells. On the other hand, lizards must first lie in the sun to heat up. In this photo, a cold tree agama has turned black to absorb more heat from the sun. When he's warm enough, he quickly changes his color back to normal so that he can impress the females. However, if you're a mammal or bird living in an extremely hot area, the extra heat your body produces creates an additional problem. Then you must find ways to get rid of it. The most common strategy is, of course, to sweat. But then you're going to lose a lot of water, something you cannot afford when water is at a premium. So what are you going to do, except avoiding the sun? Oryx, locally known as gemsbok, but also eland, have the most unusual adaptation. During warm days, they allow their body temperature to rise up to 6 degrees Celsius, that is 10 degrees Fahrenheit. By doing this, they reduce the need to cool down in the day. During the much cooler nights, gemsbok then gradually loses most of its excess heat again, starting each morning with a much cooler body. To allow their body temperature to rise above normal is unusual, if not outright dangerous. You may rightly ask how they manage to do this without damaging their brains. There's a limit to the amount of heat the body can tolerate before it dies. The main building blocks of living bodies consist of proteins, and proteins start to fall apart at temperatures above 45 degrees Celsius or 110 degrees Fahrenheit. Brains are especially susceptible to heat damage, even at lower temperatures. The last thing an animal therefore needs is warm arterial blood from an overheated body to enter its brain. So how do gemsbok prevent brain damage? The short answer is, like a car, they have a radiator in their head to prevent their engine, in this case their brain, from burning out. It consists of two parts. The first part is where the cooling of the blood takes place. When the gemsbok pants through its nose, it moves air over the wet surfaces inside the nose. This triggers evaporation of the moisture, and as we all know, when water evaporates, it takes up a lot of heat and causes the whole system to cool down. In this case, the blood in the superficial network of veins inside the nose. The second part of the animal radiator is an area immediately below the brain of the animal. This is where warm arterial blood meets the cool blood in the veins coming from the nose. In this area, a network of veins and arteries run close together, allowing heat exchange between the two. To maximize this heat exchange, it is a counterflow system. The result is that the cool blood in the veins absorb a lot of the heat from the warm arterial blood, cooling it down. The net result is that much cooler arterial blood reaches the brain, preventing brain damage. A cool system, isn't it? Or should I say, a cooling system? But enough about lack of water and overheating. What about food? Starving is another sure way to die. During wetter periods, prey animals are widely dispersed and therefore more difficult to catch. Bad news for predators. Predators counter this by traveling for longer distances each day, which would allow them to at least catch some prey animals. Herbivores, on the other hand, have more difficult times during droughts, when grass and leaves may be extremely scarce in the Kalahari. Many herbivores then migrate to places where food is available, or they switch over from eating mainly grass to eating leaves. Especially the leaves of shepherd trees are high in moisture content and protein and are readily available in most areas. When considering food, a more interesting question which we rarely consider is how animals effectively extract nutrients from their food. This is where aliens come into play. No, I'm not talking about little green men who landed in a flying saucer in some remote area. I'm talking about strangers living inside the bodies of animals, and humans for that matter. Animals need help from strangers, in this case microbes, to extract nutrients and energy from especially tough plant material. For example, there are 10 times more microbial cells in the human body, mostly in our gut, than our own human cells. These microbes belong to a few thousand different species and account for approximately 2 kilograms of a human's weight. So next time you gain weight, blame it on the strangers living inside your body. A healthy gut flora also help the Kalahari animals to process their food and avoid starvation. Especially herbivores have large areas in their bodies where plant material is fermented, either in complex stomachs, like in ruminants, or in the case of zebra or hares, in the cecums in their hindgut. Because of the large array of non-vegetarians in the Kalahari, it is also crucial to avoid predators if you want to stay alive. The conflict between predators and prey is sometimes compared with an arms race. For example, if lions, leopards and cheetahs can run faster than antelope, antelope need to have more stamina, so they can run for greater distances at full speed. To avoid being caught, antelope therefore need to be vigilant and flee before a predator is too close to them. If they flee in time, the cheetah or lion or leopard would get tired before they can close the gap between them and their desired dinner. The faster an antelope is, the shorter will be its so-called flight distance. If it is slower, like eland, it needs to have a longer flight distance, that is, start to run sooner. Ever wonder why it's so difficult to see eland from close by? Now you know. It's because they're not as fast as many other animals. Because prey animals are unwilling to be caught by predators and tend to run away as soon and as quickly as possible, predators have become stealthier in their approach, sneaking up on their prey until they're close enough to catch them with a short burst of speed. But then, antelope counter this sneaking behavior by flocking together in smaller or larger herds. The more eyes there are to see predators trying to get close to them, the better. If an individual is not able or don't want to join a herd, like territorial males, they often find a friend from a different species to guard their backs, like the springbok and hartebees in this photo. Thus, the arms race between predator and prey continues, without any one group ever getting the complete upper hand. To conclude, let's consider the war at the waterholes in the Kalahari. I've already mentioned the problem antelope have with predators at waterholes. But what about the birds? Anyone who has spent some time at the Kalahari waterhole would have noticed how nervous the birds are. If you carefully scan the wider area, you'll soon discover what you may not have noticed earlier, that birds of prey are sitting in trees some distance away from the waterhole. Specifically, pale-chanting goshawks and lanner falcons, waiting to prey on desperately thirsty birds. The larger goshawks prey mainly on pigeons and doves, while the lanner falcons usually go for smaller birds like red-billed cuilias. So what do the poor birds do to at least have a fighting chance? The doves usually sit high up in the branches of camel thorn trees where they have a good view of any hungry hawks. When they think the coast is clear, they dash down to the water and gulp up as much water as possible, quickly flying off when they see anything suspicious. There's a lot of flying up and down and false starts around these waterholes. Red-billed cuilias have another strategy. They travel in huge swarms, up to a few hundred or even a few thousand individuals. Swarming itself confuses predators because it makes it difficult for them to focus on one individual only that they want to catch. The cuilia select a thorny bush where they hide amongst the thorns, often in such numbers that the branches could barely carry their weight. When the nearest lanner falcon is far enough away for their liking, they swarm down to the water. The lightning speed with which these lanner falcons attack is something to behold. At 140 kilometers per hour or 90 miles an hour, they swoop down on these swarms of cuilias. One usually only realizes that a falcon is on his way when the swarm of cuilias suddenly rise in a panic from the waterhole and dash back to their bush. Apparently, the defenses of the cuilias are reasonably effective because I've rarely seen a falcon catching one of them. I trust you enjoy this video on how animals survive in the Kalahari. If you found it informative and interesting, feel free to subscribe to this channel so you don't miss future videos about the African wilderness. As an afterthought, if you ever get bored in the wilderness, it's because you don't ask enough why questions. So much for your parents who told you to stop asking why. Greetings until we meet again at my next video.